A lot of people coming in. Okay, there it is on. Let me mute that so I don't hear myself over there. All right. I'll start a recording for us. All right. So as usual, I'm going to mute everyone. Obviously, Steve, I want you to unmute as we see fit, probably the whole time. This week, we're talking about teaching butterfly from the deck, and all of the videos this week are from work that we've done with Steve Haufler, who's here with us. And probably something really big for me this year that I want to make very, very clear to people is that, maybe it's, I can't explain why, but something just hit from a standpoint of, all of my teaching that I do, seeing the same things over and over again, looking at where we stand as a country. And those of you that are not from the United States, I think everybody's doing a great job. But I see the same things happening with us all the time. And so there's always been a message of intensity about, the work and, how intense everybody is. And there's this kind of mentality out there of how hard you have to work. And I've always wanted to try to get a point across about the intensity doesn't have to just be about how much you do, how hard you're working, but about the shape that you're putting through the water. And I've always believed, at least the last 10, 15 years, I've believed that it's up to us as teachers and coaches to demand those movements. And so, really, when I sat down and started thinking about it, there are some, we look at the Olympic coaches and how much credit they get for the Olympians. But we have to remember that they don't actually touch those people until the end of their careers most of the time. If we go back to the beginning, probably the one that's been the most successful is Bob Bowman. Bob Bowman got Michael Phelps as a kid, brought him all the way up, went to, five Olympics, more medals than anybody else. And that's someone, in my opinion, that can take full credit for somebody. And, not that Bob did it. I mean, Michael did it. And Michael, they just had their fourth baby, I think, yesterday, fourth male child, poor Nicole. But anyway, the intensity of teaching and the way that I teach, is in going through all the videos today. Steve does so many one-time things. And whether I learned it from him or whether both of us, the way that we teach is that we don't move forward until we see what we want to see. And so the intensity that Steve shows after having worked with him for so many years, at the beginning of working with him, it was a little frustrating. Okay, I'll be honest with you, and he knows this. I would sit there and confirm your speaking language is Italian. It's not Italian, so I'm gonna switch to somebody's asking for a translation. It ain't Italian. So working with Steve initially, it was, I'd have Barbara and Steve put together this massive shot list, and it'd be like 150 shots. And I'd be there, and I'm the one underwater holding my breath and doing all this stuff. And then Steve would like, nah, that's not good enough. And I'm like, dude, it's okay. It's okay. And the longer I've worked with him, the more I totally understand that he is the most intense as far as teaching. He is the one that demands it. And that's what I want everybody to be like. I want there to be this passion in having someone do it right. And I don't see it enough. I see, if we do it enough, they'll eventually get it right. And it never works like that. It just never works like that. And so when we talk about intensity, and you hear me talk about intensity, it's really about the intensity of the movement and then what you as a teacher demand from that individual. And I know very few people that do it as well as Steve does. And again, it's just his essence and who he is. He can't stand seeing somebody not do it right. So with that said, Steve, do you want to say anything before I start going through all your videos about that sort of message?
Just when you first try to teach somebody something, It doesn't always happen right away. You got to keep doing it day after day. And eventually, if you go through the progressions and don't let them do it wrong for any amount of time, you can finally get them to get the right movement before you move on. That's it.
There are so many things that you're going to see in these videos that have pauses and that take their time. And I think that's one of the big things all of us want to get to the end as soon as possible. But the reality is, if you move on before the athlete is ready, before they've mastered something, then it's kind of pointless in a way, because you're just going to have to do it again anyway. So I see you there, Bill. Go Blue. Very cool. Okay, so we're in the app, and I've got them listed. Haufler 01, 02, 03, 04, 05, 07. It's just for me to keep them straight. So this one is, the first video is really teaching butterfly from the deck. And so I'm just going to advance it to some of the points. The first thing we do is obviously show what the end result we want. Where are we going? Where are we going with this? And so, you know, we just kind of get that image in the student's head. So then we go up onto deck. So when we talk about balance in the water, it all comes from posture on land as well. So we have to make sure that we're teaching the proper things on land before we even get to the water. And Steve, you know, if I say anything, just jump in, okay? Because I want this message coming from you rather than my interpretation, even though, you know, we've worked together for so long. I think the big things in here are the subtle details in this, but posture is very, very important, to the point that when we look at around the 38-second mark, one of the biggest issues with young swimmers is the orientation between the chin and the chest. So how much they kind of lean over in it. And so this little movement, where was it? She did it, or maybe it might have been somewhere else. But we're trying to keep the chin off the chest, but there is some extension there. There's more people coming in. So I like this so much. 44 right here. And everything is rigid, but at the same time, there's this softness to the hands. And Steve is making sure that the hands are positioned just right to keep some softness, some delicateness, is what I put in my notes. Steve, I'm going to ask you a lot of questions in this. So when we're dealing with little kids, in my opinion, are very heavy on the water. The hands go through. And so teaching the softness, even on land, obviously you've done this for a long time. This video is pretty old, but what is your thought on that?
Yeah. I mean, we use the word landing. We want the arms to land softly on top of the water. We want the arms to land splashless. We want to feel that the arms are as light as a feather and they're not going to kill the water on the entry. They're able to swing low and forward, so there's not a downward motion as they enter. And we tell them we want them to end up with the hands right on top of the water, so they're not going to be diving their hands down. The key is they have to stay out of their hands. They have to move from the shoulders. They can't move from their hands. That will cause an up and a downward motion of the recovery. I just don't like, I think one of the key things, you can't have a destructive recovery on butterfly when it causes big splashes, big up and down. So that's why we often start with the arms when we're trying to put a butterfly together. I'd like her chin up a little bit there, but
I think right there she moves it. This is what I thought the other one did, but I was looking at the wrong place in my notes. So I do have it marked out right here. So exactly what you were talking about. That's why I said, you know, when we look at it, it's keeping that chin too far down. And then sure enough, right here, that little extension is huge.
Did I say something there?
You must have. I'm giving you all the credit. Nothing happens by chance in these, Steve. It's all, you know, but it is. I mean, this is kind of where kids go, is they're tucking down because they're trying to go up and down. And so that extension, it's almost like standing at attention, keeps the head in a more forward oriented line. So obviously everybody's favorite part of this is this. Okay. So Steve has all these really cool toys around his pool. And one of them is the one for backstroke starts. It's isn't it like a gymnastics sort of roller?
It's a spotter for gymnastics for back starts.
So he uses this spotter to go on the opposite direction for backstroke, but for boards or for a butterfly to get in that position. And remember the first position we showed, which is that stressed position where we've got the hands up, the head and the chest down, the hips up and the feet down. So we've got this beautiful line. So kids won't get this naturally. And so just that slight uphill tug right there, she's going to feel it through there. And she feels that's what you're supposed to have. And if you just go instinctual, the arms are going to go down. So Steve, any comments on this?
Yes. I mean, this position with these boards set up like this, I learned this from the great Canadian Howard Furby from his book.
There's Bill.
That's a really good coach for an airplane pilot.
Yep.
Very
Howard
cool.
Furby. He was way ahead of his time. Anyway,
that's for sure.
We have every kid test out like this, and you can tell the kids that have the shoulder flexibility and the hip flexibility to be butterflyers. Now, they all don't have to be able to do this to be a good butterflyer. As they mature and get stronger, they can still have pretty good butterfly, even if they're not this flexible. Now, this 8-year-old here, now is a senior at Vanderbilt, fifth year. And she's a backstroker, butterflyer, freestyler. But we test kids like this, and we know who's going to be a little more natural on swinging the arms around and pressing their chest and getting into that special position.
So we move from that into the water. So everything's on land up till this point, and then into the water. So what we can't see here is that the swimmer is in the same position that she was in when she was standing on deck. Okay. So not on the boards, but just the stand-up position. And so what does she do? She falls forward. That's it. Just fall forward. And so to take away the idea that the legs are driving this or something else is driving this, just the idea that, and I think the next scene shows it better, because as they fall, what do we end up with? Watch this. Boom. Balanced body line, which is just tremendous. And so she's having to make some adjustments on that to get herself to this line. So Steve, what have I missed on this one?
Nothing. That's good. She's pressing her chest down. Hips are rising naturally. Eyes are a little bit too much tilted down, I think. But anyway.
Monty asks if adults can do the boards. Yes, but there would probably only be this many boards.
Yeah. I am careful with adults on this position.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
Limited a little bit as the flexibility goes away. A little bit. So take the boards, a few of the boards out. These kids are so pliable. It's ridiculous. So here it is again. She's just falling forward. And I love how controlled she is in this, Steve. Most kids, when you ask them to do this, will instinctually kick. And so this is what I'm talking about through the intensity of Steve's teaching. If you do certain things with kids in the pool, they're going to do certain things. And so they don't just fall like this. They don't just fall and do nothing and then try to get their hips up. They will fall and they will kick. And so these kids don't just happen to do this. He has taught them this, which I think is massive, massive. So just beautiful right there. Let me look at my notes. We only got one more on this one. Oh, and this is my favorite. I mean, very, very simple. A balanced body with any kind of momentum at all will travel forward. And so I just love this. It's just when you're balanced, when everything is clean, you will just continue to move forward. And so that's a good example, because basically Steve, you'll see in one of the other videos that he just gives them a little push forward, and very, very good. All right. So the next video is teaching the arm recovery on deck. And I love this. This is like this young girl is looking into a mirror. And so to mimic, to show the athletes what to do and have them mimic you, you have to have very deliberate motions yourself. And so what I love about this is how slow Steve goes. Let me just play it at full speed. Because we all see swimming as this kind of fast thing. Look at her looking at him. It's the deliberate moves that we're trying to teach people. Swimming is not natural, and swimming fast is not natural. So these deliberate moves, when you start slow, I mean, what is this kid going to be? She's what? How old here, Steve? Eight?
Eight.
And she's a fifth year at a D1 college at this point. Yes. That in itself is a massive victory. I wrote an article years ago talking about how to get your swimmers to retire. And people kind of like gave me a hard time about it. And I said, the key word there is retire. It's not quit. And so what Steve has done with this young athlete is teach her to enjoy the sport, proper skills, that she's still doing it. What is it? 16 years later, 17 years later, maybe not that long, but it's a long time. It's in the teens, which is, that's what our goal is as teachers. So these slow, deliberate movements, and how relaxed the palms are in this as well. So we start getting into.
There was a question up there from somebody.
Steve, your script talks about having hands slightly outswept. Why is that? So here.
Slightly tripped out.
Here rather than there. So more of a Y than a position 11.
Yeah, I mean, we talk about shoulder width or a little wider, because that's what I see.
Yep. And it's, if you, with the momentum of the arms coming in, if you go specifically to position 11, they'll have a tendency of coming too far in. With the power of the hands coming around, if you're slightly out, I think they end up a little bit closer in. So,
It will be different for certain kids. Some will come in a little closer, some a little wider. There we are at 11, pretty much.
Yeah, close to it. So what I wrote in my notes is this, is the way that Steve sees these kids, okay, in my opinion, and I've talked about this in my own teaching a lot, is that you're a sculptor, okay? And you're seeing what they're going to be. They don't know what they're going to be. You know what they're going to be. You know what they need. And so these small, delicate movements and just the study on what the hands are doing and the positioning of all of this stuff, it's like you are sculpting these athletes into what you know they need. And then when they grow and the physiology changes, if you have to make manipulations to it or change the teaching based on the individual, you do that. But at this age, there's some standards and systems that you go by. And you try to, you know, get people to do those things. And so I really see Steve as an artist that's trying to shape these molds of clay into something purposeful. I mean, I've always thought of swimming as an art anyway. So, yeah. So then into the water. Now, Steve, to go from here to here, is this just to get them a little bit of feel for the water or...
No, just the I don't next know. Step. Just a different way to do. If the coach can still be on the deck and just demonstrate.
You're never on the deck. So, okay. Next one we get into, I don't know if in the script on this, if it's cause I try not to listen to the script too much because I don't want to just repeat what Steve says on these things. And so, but I do know that we're getting into float, diamond, angel, swing, in this. And so again, we get into these mimic situations. Very, very simple movements. So again, body line, great body line. And then what I, yep. So there again, Steve, right there it was, it's the chin. Because again, young kids, one of the things, the reason they get this big up and down movement in butterflies is because they're taking their head down. So if you can keep the chin off of the chest, then you have a better chance of having them go forward. Now, what I like here is this, all right? To demand that the hands, the fingers trail, the wrists lead. So talk about that, Steve.
Yeah, this is one of my favorite things. I just have the hands slide out of my hands. And that way they don't pull from the hands. They pull from the shoulders. If they're pulling from their hands, they can't do this. They get stuck.
But you mean when they like slide this? Out of,
if the kid doesn't do this, I have them do it to me. I become the swimmer. I have them hold my hands and I come slide out of their hands. So they get the idea. This is one of the things in my other video, positioning techniques. Right now I'm demonstrating what kids shouldn't do. You got to be aware that they don't do that.
Steve never allows his swimmers to demo bad things. Steve demos it all. So, which is his commitment to that form, that art. Okay. And so here, taking it to the pool, we've got such a beautiful teaching environment in Orinda. So the swimmers can stand on the bottom and she's just watching and feeling the softness of her fingers going forward and then initiate that pull through that they just practiced. So they just practiced that on land and now he's coming into the water and practicing it here. Slow and delicate, as I put in my notes. And, okay, so we get into this and then, so I posted a video on Threads. I'm doing just little things on Threads. And it was a video I showed you guys last week of Grant House doing the brushwork underwater pool. And I said, if you don't have mirrors, you should use shadows. Shadows are tough because especially in this situation, you would see all this turbulence here. You're not going to get clean shadow. I encourage you, if you're teaching or really anybody, if you can, build some mirrors. These are not necessarily bought. These are built. And Steve taught us all how to build them. And so I've built a ton of mirrors in my time. But Steve has more mirrors than anybody I know. And so as the kids are watching this, she actually has a better idea of what she was doing on land now because she's seeing it than probably what she was doing on land. She was just mimicking Steve on land. So same motion, hands right around. Beautiful.
It's real important that the kids don't get stuck in the back end by getting too close to their leg and trying to push too far back. We like to round out the exit. Mm-hmm. The swimmers at Cal said the coaches call it the J sweep. I like that they were saying those things that I say. And it can make a big difference. It's kids that are pulling too far back too hard. It's a game changer if you can get them to round out the exit like that.
So we posted a video, I think there was it was a month or two ago, we were talking about butterfly, and one of the videos was the early exit on butterfly. Okay. And one of the turned out to be a student here in Illinois. Her dad told me that she watched the video, went to practice that night, tried it, changed her stroke. And then it made it so easy. And again, a lot of the reasons that the kids are going to push further back like this is because they care. And so they're trying to get in touch with the water as much as possible. And so by going out to the side, it feels less powerful, but it's a much more effective way to swim. So this rounding out the ends, I think is so important on butterfly. And that's where, you know, if you look at Steve's just the butterfly, float, diamond, angel, swing, the angel is way out there in comparison to what people would normally think. So I encourage you to watch all of those as well. There's a ton. We have 9 series with you, Steve?
Yes.
Something like that, yeah. Okay, so put some power to it. Put some weight on it. So you take the board and you hold it there. Now, the most important thing about this, if you've ever used a Vasa trainer or stretch cords or anything like that, is the elbows. Most people will try to force it and the elbows will drop. And so very, very important here, as Steve has her doing, the elbows are staying up. Look at that. Beautiful. And then mimic it here. So they go through this multiple times. I'm really talking about kind of this, you know, not so much of an out sweep, but more of a direct line. Would you say that's right, Steve?
Yeah.
Yep.
There'll be a little rounding in the beginning just to position the hands after the entry.
Okay. But the pole is pretty much straight through. Keeping it very simple, especially for young athletes. So here again, getting that nice connection, the weighted hand, push against that, and then that release. And then we try it in the water. So we're at 52. Let me look at my notes. Okay, back to float. Okay, so this is what this was. So it's basically, you're going to do that whole action once. You start in a float position. You're going to have the arms go through the exact same motions that you did on land. You're going to do it once and end up in the float position again. And any of you that have heard me talk about teaching in the endless pool, this is the give me one yeah. stroke. That's it. That's all you get. And I would tell kids, when you get it right, we're going to graduate to give me two. And so, you know, that's basically what you see here. Is if you can show me that you can do it once, then we know you can do it a billion times, maybe a million, maybe, you know, whatever. But you got to first learn the system once. And so this is where, again, when I look at this and know how kids are, I know that they have been taught by someone who's intense about technique, intense about technique. And so you can use different terms for it. I'm just using that one today because everybody wants to be intense in the world today. And so it's what you're intense about. And so demanding these forms is very, very important. So when I look at those legs, look at there's her instinct. Watch the leg. One to kick, but then she controlled it. And now she's just doing it multiple times. No legs whatsoever. Steve, where are we in the process right here?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, butterfly. I'm sorry. Yeah, butterfly float. Mm-hmm. Just float, pull, swing, float. I mean, I might say, you know, the mantra, diamond angel swing, but I really just tell them, okay, I want you to move forward, float, pull and move forward, float.
Beautiful.
Soft on your landing.
Soft on the landing. So obviously one of the big things here is peer coaching, peer teaching, you know, having kids watch other kids, they'll be more convinced that they can do these things than just telling them do it. You know, or I've had people that say, oh, I got these great swimmers. They can demo it. Don't have the great swimmers demo it. Everybody knows they're great swimmers. Never, you know, they sometimes kids don't believe that they can do those things. And so, just have your swimmers demo for each other. So here we are at head lead, and, pay particular attention to the head position and how little movement there is in this. So it's the press. And again, driving this part of her head forward, not diving down. And remember everything that we've talked about as far as the position of the neck or the chin on the chest. And so in this exercise, if you see what will typically happen is up here, you'll see the head go down. And when the head goes down, the chin goes to the chest and the athlete goes down. And now we've got this with a big kick rather than just this forward motion. Steve?
Yeah, I just tell him, I explain that there's air in her chest. Just press the air underwater and then release.
So this is where we get into everything that we've talked about for butterfly. This, where does it want to be? It wants to be up. Where does this want to be? This wants to be down. So it's so simple. Those of you that have heard me talk about this before, what's the one natural position for humans in the water? The one natural position for humans in the water. You don't have to answer. Dead man's float. Okay. Dead man's float is where we all want to be if we were just to sit out there. What is dead man float? The chest is high. The hips will eventually sink. The legs are going to be in this position with the arms dangling. So this position right here is the complete opposite of where the body wants to be, or dead man's float. The chest is pressed down, the hips are pressed up. Nature wants them to be the opposite way. So if they learn how to do this, then the then you just get into this position, and then you can kind of relax. You could almost just shut it off right there, couldn't you, Steve?
Yeah. Yeah, I just want to say I have her eyes a little more forward on this because I think it helped her stay in line better.
She was really good.
She swam at Cal.
Didn't she end up winning a national championship on a relay?
Yep, 4x50.
Okay, so you're looking at the future of a great swimmer here. The future of a great swimmer. And this was something that, you know, when she was very young.
She was 12.
Okay. And what Steve's talking about in making sure that she's moving forward. So she's got a little bit bigger gap right there in the chin, pushing her eyes forward. But the important thing here is how close the back of the head is to the surface of the water. So she's just scraping it right there. Here's a little bit deeper, press, but really good. And again, not driven too much by the legs. So that's the biggest thing that you want to watch out for is when you're doing this exercise is having the kids kick through it rather than using the chest and the hips and allowing the legs to flow behind. They're going to give a whip to it, but try to minimize that.
Try to keep the toenails underwater.
I'm going to go back a second here. There's a couple questions here. Let me... So Dan asks, how do you explain or talk about the high elbows when in the water? Do you just go back through the board thing and then put them in and back and forth a few times?
Yeah. I don't talk too much about it. I just want them to pull the water so they move forward. If they feel that, they'll keep their elbows up.
Dan, one of the things I did in the endless pool that you could do because it's
really and the mirrors help.
The mirrors definitely help. Again, the visual part of it. And again, the endless pool had the mirrors. But I would get them to initiate the pull with their elbows on the surface of the water. So if they were flat in this position, the elbows would initiate high. And then once they connected up with the elbows on the surface of the water, they could do anything they wanted because we've started the process with the elbows in the right way. So Steve could have these swimmers do this in the flat position. But as soon as you start doing this, the elbows are going to be a little bit farther under and you don't want to, you know, impinge the shoulders at all. But Barbara?
Yeah, one thing you could try is the have them try to push themselves up out of the pool just to find that power position.
Oh. We have to make sure when they do that, that they don't do this.
Exactly. Well, I think they probably won't, but just initiate. Yeah. Or push
initiate
out
it. Initiate
yeah,
it.
We do that. Not lift out, yeah. We do that every day, and we have them do it correctly, Barbara. Yes, that's how we get out of the water.
And Steve, there's a note here. I have to honor Steve now for his butterfly teaching drills. It's now around 10 years. I use this perfect drills and this, and it works. So that's Anders Malmquist. And Anders, are you from Sweden by any chance? Which is pretty good. Steve, you've influenced the world, which we all know. You know, it's very cool. And I think that's a great compliment. Anders, he has influenced me as well. And pretty much everybody I know loves this guy. So, so manipulation. So I think we got it like the first one here. So you're trying to keep the head stable while the body rotates around it. And sometimes the athletes fight you. So when we look at this, I think, yeah, the first one right here, she got it. And then she started fighting you a little bit. She was pushing the head forward. So we're going to focus on this first one right here. And you see the articulation of the chin as her chest moves forward. Steve takes the head, tries to hold it in the same spot. And so what ends up happening is the head will rotate back this way ever so slightly. And the goal is to keep it in the same place. So as this moves forward, if the head stays in line, she's going to peck down. Okay. And so it's a counteractive sort of thing. So as the chest moves forward, he lifts the chin and the head right there. And then she started fighting him a little bit on it. Kind of get it. And then of course I saw what she was doing. So you had to get close and just get her to laugh. because we try to have as much fun as possible, especially with these kids when we're making these videos. So talk about the butt bump, Steve.
Just something else to get the kids to move.
I think it's good because it associates them where some of this power is coming from. It's not from the legs. And so if they feel, some of that, pelvic tilt or twist or, and kind of pushing that back, it articulates the back. It's such a simple sort of thing to keep everything off except the rear, because the hips are going to be involved in this no matter what. Let's see, where are we? Okay. And then we take it here. So if you have kids that overkick, and Steve, you confirm or tell me your thoughts on this. If there's kids that overkick, strangely enough, if you put fins on them and tell them not to kick, the legs get limited because you have increased surface area. So they can still move forward without the pressure of the kick. And so, Steve?
Yeah, that's fine. That's good.
Yeah. So less movement from the legs, but and now she's got some rhythm going with it. I like to call this, you're dribbling your chest down the pool, because if you push it down, it wants to come up. And so you're going to get into this rhythm that's just down, up, down, up. And as long as you follow the chest and the hips, it's a very simple exercise. It's when they try to overpower with the legs that they go too high and too low. Okay. Just a few more here. It's a Friday. Hand lead butterfly. So now we take the hands and move them out front. I'm going to mute all just in case. So Steve, unmute yourself again. Just somebody has their mic open. There you go. Okay. Not too big of a kick here. All right. So here we go. What I love about this is that there's patience in between some of these, that she is keeping very shallow, but she's taking her time with it. It's not, if you do these drills with a large group of athletes, then you inevitably will get kids that want to race each other. And so one of the things that you want to encourage them to do is to not race, to slow down. And in fact, the person that finishes first loses. And so, playing games with them from that standpoint is good, but it's about the focus is really who wins is the person that does it the best. And so when we look at this, we're looking at how deep the hands go and how high they go in this line. And then for this particular exercise, are they involved in this? Are they aiming you down, or are they part of the extension of the body? And so right now, the hands are just being driven forward by the rotation of the body. Okay. So just like we saw before, the when you push forward, as long as the body is balanced, they'll continue to move. So where are we? 44. So push into the balance line. So there she goes. And she's allowed one body dolphin. That's it. One body dolphin. There she goes. And then back to the line. Very, very simple, very easy. So Steve, another one, Gustavo from Puerto Rico. It's the first time I use these drills and would like to thank Steve because they will work for my swimmers. Absolutely, Gustavo. This is like a roadmap to butterfly, all of these things. It's like a cheat sheet. I tell people all the time, we have progressionary systems on the website that if you're an assistant coach, all you got to do is read one day ahead of all the kids and make them do that. So, Charity, are you talking about the iPad screen is muted or my screen is muted? Can everybody else hear me? Okay. So the iPad, I have no sound on it, if that's what it is, because it would be disruptive. So here we go again. So the first one, Steve pushed her into balance line. And the second one, who again, the athlete is a little bit older, has a little bit more ownership of the water. She jumps into the balance line and still does one dolphin and then back to float. So just one. Very simple, very patient. Let's see here. I think that was basically, go ahead. Steve.
Ideally, you got to keep those hands high. You can't use the hands. You can't do hula hands. You can't bend your, break your wrist and use your fingers to guide. You just want fingers and wrists straight ahead. And this is the hard part. A lot of kids that they do too much of that, even though she kept her hands nice and straight. That's a challenge.
I think this one obviously was anytime you put something out there, they're going to go deeper on it unless the goal is to hit the back of the head or the back on the lane line. So, but I still think she did a great job.
Yeah, she's.
And then here it is again with fins, float, one body dolphin, back to float.
And so the big thing, often
go ahead.
We'll tell them to feel like they're going under a log. And as soon as they go under, they want to rise back up so they don't scrape their back.
And then you're too nice, Steve. All right. Let's go for the next one, which is teach timing separation drill. Now, separation drill for breaststroke is one of my favorite drills, especially for a modern breaststroke. And so separation drill for butterfly is very much the same thing because you have to control what you're doing. So what Steve does is first practice the pull. So mimics the pull on deck and the recovery. So for those of you that watched all of Steve's videos, float, diamond, angel, swing. So it would be float, diamond, angel, swing. And then what he does is he goes up and he's going to do one body dolphin. So that's the whole system. Now, the reason he stood up from here, okay, is that he wants to demonstrate, again, this is an intense teacher. And again, when I say that, it doesn't mean he's screaming at his kids because he's wanting them to do things. He's intense in what he demands for them to do. And he does it in a very nice way. So he's not going to demonstrate the pole in the vertical position because he wants them to see it in the horizontal position. So this is just the way, in my opinion, Steve's mind works, okay? And so here's the pole. He's in the right position, finishes. Then he takes that, stands up, because the next and separate move is the body dolphin. That's separation drill. So they get one pull and recovery, back to float, and then one dolphin kick. Or one body dolphin, better way to say it, right, Steve?
Yeah.
Okay. So here she comes. She jumped into the float position. There's one, very little kick. She has a little bit of a kick there, but back to here, and then body dolphin. Go one more time. Pull, recovery, back, and then body dolphin. And then just floats. Now she's going to do it multiple times here. And as I know we said this in the video, you'll notice now that as she starts to put it together, and this happens in, there's still people coming in. This happens in breaststroke separation drill as well. And it's actually the goal of it is that you will speed people up in separation drill to the point where they start making mistakes, where they're not really doing separation. That mistake is their stroke. That's where we want them. And so what's happening here is that as she does multiple versions of this, they start to come together. That's the way it's supposed to be. And so as Steve says on the video, I did listen to this one. You'll see that the kick, the timing is more natural to where it should be. The big thing for me on this is the pause in between each one. That there's taking time, we call it review and rehearse. And so after you finish one, you'll think, what just happened? How did I do? Was that good? Was that bad? What do I need to change for the next one? And then you rehearse what you're going to do for the next one, and then you set it up. So, Steve, what do you got on this one?
Well, when she starts putting it together like this, I would just say, now, this time, press your chest before your arms land, and that creates the body dolphin. And then it becomes a continuous butterfly. And then the hands keep moving because they've created that stress position right there that wants to keep moving.
Yep. Now, I think what we did here on the video is that this is one of those things that you're going to work with somebody on a particular skill. And if you just work on the skill the whole time, they go a little nuts. So you take the training wheels off and you just let them go and swim. And so see how it comes out. Let's see. Is this teaching DVDs from Steve? became a version two, should include diving and breathing drills. So first of all, they're not DVDs anymore. It's been a long time for DVDs, but all of these videos are on the website. And so you can get to all of them very quickly. Dan says, get back to body float between each stroke and pull. Yes. In that, and you're going to see it again here. So I feel that there's kind of a, you do the drill, you try to apply it, and then you come back to the drill. And so sometimes you go back and forth between these things. So here it is there. And she's floating a little bit, and now she's starting to put it together just a little bit more. Is this? No, okay. All right, I'm just looking at my notes. Okay, so now she's swimming and starting to add some breathing to it as well. And I think it's at 125. We start to see, here's the breath. So basically, you're just building these building blocks on it. And now the last one is when we teach the breathing. So again, that athlete was pretty advanced at that point. So so let's see. Okay. And finally, the last one is talking about breathing. So we get to about the 13-second mark here. And he's going to allow how many strokes? One. So, you know, if you're teaching young kids or you're teaching masters that are learning butterfly, the last thing you want to do is say, okay, now we're going to add breathing to it. So go 10-50s breathing, because you just did 10-50s non-breathing, I'm sure. You know, so do one movement first. Think about one. It's a skill. And so you're trying to teach the skill. So she gets one stroke back to float. Okay. And now if we break that down a little bit, where are her hands when her head breaks the surface of the water? Okay. Where are her hands? They're not even close to being done. Okay. About halfway through. And then the face comes back in the water before the hands come back in the water. So beautiful. See, there's a couple questions here. Let's see. Oh, did it jump up? Sorry, everybody. Okay. No, we're good.
Let me just say what I say, because it's sometimes you say things that are not exactly what the swimmer will do, but I'll say, start to breathe as soon as you move your hands. And she thinks of that, but she air's happening right here. And then with the mirror, I want you to see your face before you see your arms land. That gets their head back down fast.
Look at her eyes. Yep. So this is the really fun one. Because again, this is, how old was this one? She's eight at this point. And, you know, you look at the top butterflies and you see where their breath is. Look at how low that is. Now, you know, you could take this picture. We could Photoshop Steve out of it, and we could say, you know, this is an Olympic champion, and that's basically what it would look like. But how many strokes has she taken? She's taking one stroke right now, I think. Oh, is she going to take more? All right, never mind. But look at that. Look at how low that head is to the water. So here we go again. And again, it's limiting until they can do it right multiple times. So here's Steve, demo again. So apply, then review, then apply, then review, then apply, then review. And here he's throwing her into it. One stroke, boom, back to float. And I think this is the last, I mean, look at that. So look at the, and what I like to think about is, okay, this one was higher. Yeah, this one was higher, which we did talk about. But when you get back to this, if we go to here, what I like to think about is, what is the line between the torso and the head? If she was just standing up, where would she be looking? And this is ever so slightly up, okay? But in mostly her head's pretty much in line. It's when the kids have this, their back comes up and then their head is straight up like that. Well, you know, at that point, the hips are going to be down and it's going to be very difficult for them. So this line right here, and then you think of gravity is just going to pull her right back down. And there she goes in long before the hands come around. Up a little high on that one. Yep. So she had to do it again.
Glenn, there was some question about teaching breathing or not teaching breathing, or I just saw something.
Okay. So Gustavo said, is it better to teach, to start teaching butterfly with fins or without to little kids? Steve, why don't you take that?
We'll spend, let's say we're doing a butterfly week. One day we'll go through all the drills without fins, and the next day we put the fins on.
So I think it's situational. It's if the kid's kicking too much, you put fins on them and you tell them not to kick. That's just my method. And so what that means is that when you tell someone not to kick, they're still probably going to kick if they have a massive kick, but they're going to kick just a little bit because the fins are going to, it's harder to kick with big fins on. The next one is from Julie. Steve, do you encourage young children to also not put their chin on their chest for just dolphin drill? A lot of them use the motion, letting their chin lead the way whilst learning dolphin. And so I think that's more of a snaking sort of move if the chin goes down. And I think that's where that drill where Steve was holding the swimmer's head to not allow that to happen. Is that correct, Steve?
Well, that's a very good question because I've seen some things with Gary Hall Jr. has put online encouraging that chin motion. So,
but at what level?
I guess he's looking at world class.
See, this is where everybody just gets, it drives me crazy. Okay. And we all have to understand, most of us aren't dealing with world-class swimmers. We're teaching people how to swim. Everybody, yeah, we want to know what the top people are doing, but most people can't do that. And so these, what Steve is teaching here is going to be great for 95 to 98% of the human population on the planet for learning how to swim butterfly. If you want to manipulate that, when you get past Olympic trials or you're going to win the Olympic Games, yes, you have to make small manipulations. To teach some of these things on a whole is incorrect. I'll just say it. It's right. Just wrong. And so toughest part about, keep it simple. What's our motto for 2024? Simplify and apply. Keep it simple. Make them do it. Be a parent with a curfew. If I tell you that you got one stroke and you take two, get out. Well, maybe not that much, but you know, but it's just demanding. And again, this is the intensity of what Steve does. He does it in such a soft way, but he is one of the most intense people, the way that he watches and views. And this is the model. This is the guy. This is what we want everybody to look at swimmers like. How can they be better? Not how can I be better? How can they be better? And something that I totally appreciate, Steve, the longer that I've known him, I don't get so annoyed anymore because I know that what comes out is gold. At the beginning, I just wanted to get the videos done.
There was a good question there about kick in, kick out.
So Cindy says, at what point do you talk about kick in and kick out time, especially for master swimmers? We've got some master's coaches here, but Steve, go ahead and take that.
That's a good question. Again, you got to be careful. What I don't like to happen, and I call it the double bump, is when they press their chest twice and their hips go up twice because they're over kicking. They're not just letting it flow. I just have to look at each individual swimmer and what to say or not say.
Yeah, that's so important.
It works for some people to get them to use their legs. So sometimes this progression, they'll just float their legs through. And I need to rev up those legs a little bit. And often when they start to race, then the legs come in a little better.
All right, Barbara. So Barbara picked all the videos again as usual. So these are great.
There weren't any other ones to pick. It had to be Steve.
There was one more question that just came up from Mati or something? Or
is it best to try to have them master the stroke without breathing and then go to breathing? Yeah, Mati, yes. I don't think we got to breathing until the sixth video. So right.
We only swim butterfly, you know, three strokes, no breathing, practice, and then we teach them how to breathe.
Except Monty may be coming here. We might be going to the pool together or having lunch or something. I'm going to make Monty do a bunch of 25 no breather butterflies. You know, we'll see. See how he handles it. So I'll be nice. Yeah, there you go. There you go. So the last one about the timing kicking for masters, Barbara, or any other masters coaches here, what is your thought on the kicking the timing? How do you do it?
I don't worry about that two different kicks until they're a little bit more advanced. Just I was really focusing on just teaching butterfly right now, not kind of perfecting it. I have them, the master swimmers that I coach, and they're total beginners, just do one cycle. It's just like, give me one, come up and get a breath, and then we're going to try it again. So there's really just that one kick. And then Steve, when they kind of get it, they're putting in that second kick automatically. I don't talk about it. I just one cycle at a time is the way to teach the basics, I think.
I think if it is an issue, I just go with single arm and just have them say it. So, you know, whether it's kick the hand in or kick the hand out, just go to single arm and we take the full stroke out of it. So we'll do, you know, three right, three left, and then see at that point. Matthew asks, would you say the kicks are different strengths or just different? One a hip kick, another a knee kick. That's a good question. I mean, I've had it go both ways where some people have the front kick is heavier than the back kick or the, you know, and then people describe kick one and kick two differently. So as in the immortal words of my friend Wayne Goldsmith, if it's faster, it's faster. So figure out what's working for your athletes and just keep playing with it.
Yeah.
Andres has a question. Go ahead, Steve. Sorry.
Hips and heels. Watch a good butterfly. Hips and heels. And so they press the chest. You got the hips. The body goes through the line. The heels come up, snaps back in. There's your second kick that straightens the body. The second kick lines up the body. It doesn't cause the hips going up again.
Anders has a question. Anders, go ahead.
Yes. Like Steve said, the flow. You have to get the flow, and the arms, normally they breaking down the speed. You don't need them. When you have them, try with one, try with two, left, right side. The flow is important. And when you get the flow and the rhythm with the hips up and down, it's working automatically. Yes.
It should follow, yeah, unless the person's trying to drive from the kick. That would be the difference. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Anders. Perfect. Thank you.
What's that question from Cindy?
Yeah, I see that. But first, Nancy says kick hands in, kick hands out. Again, thoughts. I do that if I'm teaching somebody, do single arm because it's easy to time it that way. Cindy says, can you find an example of hips and heels in these videos? I think
it's just anybody swimming butterfly.
Yeah. Okay, let me grab this one really quick.
Not an underwater shot.
I knew you were going to say that because that's what I pulled up, but because I knew where it was. So there would be hips, there would be heels. So it's hips and heels. Okay.
So that's what you see.
Yeah. So from the surface, you see hips and then you see heels. So I don't know I didn't know where the above water stuff was. And I didn't load it on the iPad. We could go to the website and find it, but whole different thing. Okay, good news and bad news. Good news is everybody gets next Tuesday off, because I'm going to be flying to Arizona. I'll be filming some UK Olympians next week in Flagstaff. Barbara, we just worked it all out. So you and I will talk about if we need to make adjustments on the schedule, so that we're doing something cool for the Zoom. But next week, I don't think we're going to be able to do it because I will be on a plane, and then I'm going to be hiking with my buddy Brent Rudemiller. We're going to go for a hike to celebrate Cancer Free, and then I'm going to drive to Flagstaff and film for a couple of days and have a hard time breathing. So, yeah. All right. If there's nothing else, thank you. Oh, there's another question. Two couple more. All right, good. People talking. All right, everybody. Thank you very much. We'll see you in 2 weeks. And yes, something else? Anybody? Bring back some warm weather. Yeah, I hear you.
Topic in 2 weeks is going to be how to find your lats and get them engaged.
That's a good one. How to find your lats. That's an excellent one. So important for swimmers. All right, everybody. Thank you again. We will see you in a couple of weeks. Appreciate you, and be safe, and we'll talk to you soon.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you, Steve.
You're welcome. Thank you, Steve.
Okay.
All right. Bye.